I'm a liver pathologist, and what I will discuss is how to improve histological score for NASH. So these are my conflict of interest. So histology is crucial for NAFLD. And whatever you look around, the definition of the disease is based on histological changes. And this is a document from FDA, and there are also other many that describe that histological changes are the major features that define and assess the progression of the disease. And there are currently no clinical or biological criteria to identify the group of patients. So biopsy is there and will be there for a while, and because if a diagnosis of NASH is required, then you need liver biopsy. It's essential for clinical trial, as you know, for eligibility and also for primary endpoint for interim analysis. It's also useful out of the clinical trial in case, of, for example, of comorbidities, or if there is a suspicion of advanced liver disease. But let me go back 40 years when the story began. The story began with this paper, which was published by Jürgen Ludwig, who was a pathologist of the Mayo Clinic. And Dr. Ludwig isolated a group of 19 cases of patients which were non-alcoholic, but which had a typical biopsy of acute alcoholic hepatitis. So at that time, the things was relatively easy because the pattern, the histological pattern of the disease was very typical. This was a very, very small subset of what we call now NAFLD. And as the typical, the histology was very typical, it was very easily recognizable, and there was no problem of observer variation at that time. The disease is a severe disease, and there, it was at a high risk of progression. But again, it was a very small subset. Then the things in the 10 years have a little bit changed because based on several studies, including the Angulo study, the Matteoni studies in gastro, it appears that the spectrum of NASH should be extended and the disease expanded in, from the typical severe form that was initially defined to very mild disease. But with this extension, still the dichotomous application NAFL versus NASH was kept. The problem when doing that is the characterization of the mild disease at the frontier become very uneasy. The correlation also with prognostic became loose because you include severe disease, but also most of them were not severe disease. And because of the wide spectrum of the disease, the identification of biomarker was uneasy, and as we discussed just before, there is so far no validated non-invasive biomarker for the NASH. In order to separate or spare this group of disease, the NASH CRN produced the NAFLD activity score. The NAFLD activity score, or NAS, that you know, is based on the semi-quantitative evaluation of three features, steatosis, inflammation, and ballooning. This was very useful at the beginning to characterize the disease and to describe the disease. But now, with time passing, 15 years more, it appears that there are some limitation or even some mistakes. The first one, and we discussed that in the previous session, is that steatosis, which is a strong part of the NAS, is not really a marker of activity. It's not a direct driver of fibrosis. Again, we discussed that previously. And even if you include steatosis in the NAS, it should not be as important as it is because it's 3 out of 8. The second point is that we know now, and we all agree that the major feature is ballooning. And ballooning is underweighted in the NAS. It's only 2 versus 3 for inflammation and 3 for steatosis. So clearly there is a problem of balancing the different features into the NAS. The second issue is that the scoring is not accurate enough. And there are several studies we have shown that grading inflammation and grading ballooning are at least moderately reproducible. I just put here some studies which have looked to the kappa, the inter-observer variability between expert liver pathologists, for the different components of NASH, total NASH diagnosis, steatosis, inflammation, and ballooning. And if you look to inflammation and ballooning, you see that the kappa value are less than 0.5 for inflammation and around 0.5 for ballooning. So it means they are modest or moderate. This is explained simply because the criteria for definition of the different grades of the disease are probably too vague or too inaccurate. And if you look, for example, to the definition of grading ballooning, 0, 1, 2, the only definition we have is 0 for known, 1 for few, and 2 for many. But we don't know where to put the threshold between few and many. And few and many for me should be different for few and many for another pathologist. And this explains probably the relatively high inter-observer variability in scoring this feature. So the consequence is NAS has never demonstrated a significant prognostic value in the outcome of the disease, and that there is significant inter-observer variability in scoring. And this is a major challenge in the phase 3 clinical trial, because as you know, most of them need to assess the NAS and have a NAS more or equal to 4 with 1 point in each of the category for a biopsy to be eligible. And given the limitation I took before, this comes, of course, an important issue. Let's now move to the second component of the disease, which is fibrosis. Fibrosis, of course, is very important, and it has been described in details by the NASH CRN, and you have here the different stage, we say grade for activity and stage for fibrosis, which have been used for defined for by NASH CRN from 1 to 4 for cirrhosis, 1 being subdivided into A1, B, and C. I have no time to go in details. So this is very important, and this is very efficient because several studies, and I just put here 2 of them, that have shown that the scoring of fibrosis, especially stage 3 and of course stage 4, are related to liver-related mortality or overall mortality. So these scoring systems are a major prognostic factor independently of any other factors. However, there are some weaknesses which need to be also think about. First, it does not capture perisinusoidal fibrosis. And perisinusoidal fibrosis is a hallmark of NASH. This is what you see here in a very severe disease. You see ballooning, you see steatosis, inflammation, and this perisinusoidal fibrosis. And I have no time to go back, but none of the histological stage of fibrosis do not capture this fibrosis. The second is that it's poorly descriptive in advanced fibrosis, and there is not enough granularity to capture the change, especially if we address to short-term clinical trials regarding F2 and F3. And I just put here 4 images of 4 different biopsies, which will be graded stage 3 according to NASH CRN. This one has a bridging fibrosis, this one has few bridge, this one has many bridges, and this one has many bridges with some but focal nodularity. So if you apply the NASH CRN, they all will go to stage 3, and of course they have not the same prognostic and evolution. So the last weakness is the early definition. I mentioned that we have 1A, 1B, 1C. This is very early stage. This is descriptive, but it's only for pathologists. Because there is no clinical relevance, there is a high inter-observer variability, And there is a risk of sampling error, which is very important if you address this early lesion. I put here the kappa value of fibrosis. If you use the NASH CERN simply 1, 2, 3, and 4, you pull together stage one, you see that it's excellent. But if you go in detail and add one A, B, and C, it decreases to something which is a moderate kappa value. So these early stages are probably not very useful. So my demonstration, so it's probably time to move forward. Because the dichotomous approach between NASH and non-NASH is surely an oversimplification of the reality. And we need a more flexible approach because we know that the disease come and go. And it's not one day white and the other day black. This is a progressive change. And we need, it does not fit well with the classification in category. As I mentioned, the NAS has conceptual and practical important limitation, mainly observer variability of the two important criteria. And the staging of fibrosis, also clinically relevant, needs an in-depth review to capture more information. And what I said is not only my evaluation or my concept, it has been also recently underlined in this article from APT, which is signed by US and Australian clinical pathologists, including most of the liver pathologists of the NASH CRN. So I think that there is a consensus as we need to move forward. So how to do that? Well, I think that, again, we should consider three things. The three lesions that we see under the microscope, steatosis, which is a marker, activity, which is a driver, and fibrosis, which is a killer. And having a more linear scale, for example, like the Metavir, for example, for activity and fibrosis, give you a lot of possibility and more flexibility to stage and grade the disease. What about the scoring of fibrosis? I say we could move forward and have something which is more adapted. Put together one A and B and C for the reason I mentioned before, it's stage one. Change the scoring of stage two because in the stage two, it's supposed that you have pericentral fibrosis and periportal fibrosis, but the fibrosis does not jump from one place to another place. There is in between the perisinusoidal fibrosis, which should be mentioned in this intermediate stage, and increase the granularity of advanced fibrosis. Three and four should move into four different scoring systems. And if you go back to the image I showed before, where all were stage three CRN, you have now the stage two, three, because there is few bridging fibrosis, there is a number which is defined. Four, because you have here many bridging fibrosis. And five, because it's something which is known as incomplete cirrhosis, where you have these many fibrous bridge, but you have someplace some nodularity. So you increase the granularity, but you also increase the reproducibility, because here you define clearly what are the limits, what are the different stages, and how do you classify the borderline cases. This is also interesting because if you compare the scoring system with the amount of fibrous tissue, which is something very useful when you want to develop biomarkers, you see that, and this is from a huge database with close to 3,000 biopsies, which has been assessed using collagen proportional area, which is morphometry. We clearly see that the increase of amount of fibrous tissue on the biopsy is not linear according to NASH CRN, but is exponential. We know that already because there were several other articles which have shown that, but here this is clearly exponential. And if you use the 0 to 6 scoring system I have shown you, you see here that it is much more linear in the advanced, especially in the advanced stages. So using this type of scoring system might be very useful to design biomarkers which will be more relevant because It's very difficult to modelize that, but probably more easy to modelize this curve. So the other issue is, if we want to improve the scoring, we have to define and mitigate a new NAFLD activity score. So to my view, there should be not have steatosis, as again, it's a marker and not a driver of the disease. We should give equal weight for inflammation, lobular, and ballooning. And each of these scoring should show, before publicizing them, a strong observer reproducibility for any feature. To me, it makes no sense to define a new scoring system if you don't validate this observer variability before. This is what we did with the SAF score. I don't have time to go in detail. But with this approach, where we define in detail the scoring of ballooning and inflammation from 0 to 2, you see that you can reach substantial inter-observer variability with kappa value, which are more than 0.7. And how to do that? Again, you have to describe the lesions. What we did with the Litmus Consortium, the EU-funded consortium, is to provide an atlas of histological images with something of 100 histological image, and we explain in this atlas how to grade this image, how to stage this image, and we put the pressure of the in the borderline cases in order that pathologists have a clear view of how to grade that. And when you do that, you can expect to get some relevant data. So my take-home message, I think a lot what will be the more important take-home message. It's clearly that we have to move forward, but when you want to look to the future, it's really important to look to the past. And looking to the past, and it is especially relevant for this meeting, is to see what happened in the scoring of chronic viral hepatitis. You surely know how we did for scoring viral hepatitis. It was not a diagnostic problem, but evaluating the severity of the disease. The story starts in 1960 with the definition of two different entities, chronic active hepatitis and chronic persistent hepatitis. And it was supposed that it was two different diseases, but clearly it clearly appears that it did not cover all the features. We need other definition, and that this is not so dichotomous approach. So there was another introduction of another feature, which was chronic lobular hepatitis, but it was still a classification by category. Then came the clinical trials, and clinical trials need scores. Of course, it was not for defined disease, again, but because we had the viral marker, but it was to assess the severity. And then comes the nodal histological index. Nodal was very famous, but the histological index, which have been used for all these trials with pegylated interferon, ribavirin, et cetera, had a significant conceptual mistake, which was it added activity and fibrosis into a single score, which is, does not make sense, as we know now. And we had to wait for 15 years, because it's always complicated when clinical trials are started with one criteria to change it. We have to wait 15 years to get to other scoring system, which appears to be more relevant as Metavir or Ishak, with a clear definition of A and F. Now, what happens for NAFLD? And it's very interesting because it's very parallel. We had the initial definition by a dichotomous approach, which I show you before, the NAFL-NASH with a Mayo Clinic experience. Then the NASH classification extended, thanks to the work of Beth Brunt and Nash Sheeran, with subcategories that was added, and Liver Forum did the same, but it was still categories. Then the clinical trials arrived, 2005. Then there was a need of a scoring system, which is really the same as what happened here, and this was an NAFLD activity score. And as there was a mistake in the concept of Knödel histology activity index, there is the same mistake in the NAS. So again, we have maybe now to wait 15 years. And if you have 15, if you add 15 years to 2005, then we are now. So it's time to move forward. Thank you for your attention.